children with his first wife who died. He married Mary Jane Cochran, who was Nellie's mother. She was a widow who was childless when she married him, but then had these five children, of which Nellie was the third of five after two brothers, and then another brother followed, and a younger sister. Her placement in the family is interesting for a number of reasons, which you'll see. And so they lived in this house, but then Michael Cochran dies when Nellie is only about 7 or 8 years old. And the family fortunes, of course, he was a very substantial mill owner, but the legacy was divided among 16 people. A third, the widow's dower, which she got only the income from, and the rest among his many, many children. So there was not a lot of money to go around. While he was still alive, they moved to this beautiful house in Apollo, which is about 10 miles from Cochran's Mills, but then they quickly had to give it up as soon as he passed. So Mary Jane moves with her five. His older children are already old and pretty much established. They own drugstores, and they're substantial people in town, in Apollo, and they move into this house. And money is clearly a problem. So she marries John Jackson Ford, this real SOB. He's a drunken lout. She tries to set him up in a business, a drugstore sort of business. He fails at that. He's drunk all the time, and he's abusive, really abusive. He's a table flipper. He threatens her with a gun. She went to a thing at the Methodist church. He's mad about it. He comes in brandishing his weapon. I mean, he was really whack. And given the times, of course, she's married to him, right? But this is not a great environment for her young children, as you can imagine. So she takes the really huge step of filing for divorce. By this point, Nellie is 14. She's known as Pink, by the way, because she always was dressed in pink while all the other girls are dressed in brown. She always was a little special, so she's known as Pink or Pinky. And she testifies at this divorce hearing. It's all hand transcribed, and you see the sorts of things. This is just a small segment. He threatened harm. She was afraid of him. She saw him throw clothes after being washed on the floor, and then takes them out into the garden, and then pours water all over the iron clothes. I mean, he really was not a nice man. And most of this testimony was corroborated by neighbors. It's all part of this file. So Nellie finds out from her guardian, Samuel Jackson, who's actually married to one of her half-siblings, and he's in charge of the trust. He's a banker in Apollo, and that she has $400 in her trust, which at the time was not insignificant, enough to get her through normal school, which was a teaching college that had just been established in Indiana, Pennsylvania, about 20, 25 miles away, I guess. And she starts school. She's going to be a teacher. She lasts through the first semester, but there's no grades for her for the semester. She clearly did not finish because suddenly there was no money. And whether he mismanaged it, whether her mother was borrowing the funds because she needed them, you know, to support the other siblings, it's hard to say what exactly happened. Years later, in very Nellie Bly fashion, she sued him when she came of age, because she would do that. Thank goodness for her litigious record, or I would not have had a book. She was suing people all the time, or they were suing her. You'll see more of that. So she only lasts barely a semester, and there are no grades recorded, so she doesn't really even finish the term when she finds out there's no money to stay. In the meantime, her mother moves to Pittsburgh, where two of her brothers have settled, trying to make their way. They're salesmen, kind of doing their thing. The mother establishes a boarding house, so they all live there, and then they take boarders, and that's how they support themselves. But of course, money is forever a problem. So Nellie, because of her character, takes on the position of the family supporter. She sees herself as responsible for this family, much more so than her brothers, one of whom is already a little fond of alcohol, the other one's half a ne'er-do-well. I mean, it's just going to happen that way. So she reads the paper avidly, the Pittsburgh Dispatch. At that time, Pittsburgh was spelled without the H, so that's not a mistake. And there's a columnist who she's very interested in, whose name is Erasmus Wilson, known as QO, the Quiet Observer. And he, at this certain point, is writing day after day about the uselessness of girls and how they should stay out of business and other enterprises, because of course this is, you know, 1885, women are starting to come to the fore and find out, just as Nellie had, that they can trade for professions. And he's having none of that. You know, what are girls good for? So she, like many young women, write back to complain about these columns he's writing. But hers is somehow special. So George Madden, who's the editor, this guy right here, sees her letter and says, the grammar's terrible, the punctuation's awful, but there's a spirit here. I see a spirit here. Let's see if we can find this girl. Of course, she had signed herself Lonely Orphan Girl. And the reason she had a guardian appointed was because a mother, widowed, would have to have a man to take care of money, because we're not allowed to do that. So she called herself Lonely Orphan Girl, even though she still had a mother. And so this actually appears in the paper right here. It's a note on the editorial page. Not easy to find, but I found it. If the writer of the communication signed Lonely Orphan Girl will send her name and address to this office merely as a guarantee of good faith, she will confer a favor and receive the information she desires. So they hire her. And of course, no young woman at that time would have her name in the paper except at birth, at marriage, or death, right? Never. So a pen name was inevitable. You had to have one. So at the time, there was a Stephen Foster song that was very popular called Nellie Bly. Does anyone know it? Can anyone sing it? Nellie Bly, Nellie Bly, bring the broom along. You really don't want me to sing it. Yeah. But if you listen to The American Experience, my daughter sings it, and she sings it well. So they give her, that someone's humming the song. It actually was written about a young slave girl. Stephen Foster wrote it at someone's house. He saw the young girl come up from the kitchen, and he just banged out the tune, and that's how the song came to be. Another little saga, but it became her pen name, and it was Nellie I.E., not Nellie Y. like the Stephen Foster song, but that became her pen name, and that's how that happened. And so she thinks she's going to embark on this great career. So what's the first thing she writes about? Bad marriages, which she seems to know something about. The girl puzzle, you know, why are girls starting to work? She makes the argument, a very good argument, that some girls needed to support their families, and that QO had really neglected to understand that this was a very compelling reason for women to be working. She wrote about bad marriages. She goes into the workshop. She wants to write about child labor and what's going on. But what happens in the workshops of Pittsburgh? She's led around by the managers, and guess what she sees? Nothing. Because, and I believe, I would like to think, and I'm sure it's true, that's where she gets the idea that if you really want to find something out, if you really want to investigate, you can't call up the PR department. You know, it's not going to work for you. And these stories, which the juvenile books about her give a lot of credence to, are really very dull. There's like one little exchange with an 8-year-old worker, without much about, you know, what it means for a child to be laboring like that at 8 years old. But they're really very benign. And because the situation was whitewashed. By September, her name is in the headline, as you can see. So this is from January to September of her first year working as a 21-year-old girl. This headline with her name in it, this is the first of every single other story she writes for the rest of her working life. Now, I'm a journalist. Any journalists in the room? So it's hard to imagine how unusual that is for someone to have that, especially in a time when bylines were not even so common yet. People weren't really even signing their work. So it tells you that something special was going on with this young woman. Well, she wants to get on the front page. She wants to write like the guys. And that is just not happening for her. They keep assigning her to write about flower shows and fashion and all the women's page sort of stuff. She's got a fantastic voice. That's why she's getting this kind of recognition. So she just says, well, the heck with all of this. I'm going to take my mother as chaperone, and we are going off to Mexico. And she's going to become a travel writer and write about politics and really up her game. That's her strategic idea, to spend 6 months there, which she does. Writing back with under contract to the Dispatch, these pieces that run several times a week for the 6 months, Nellie in Mexico. She writes about everything, and you see that She has a curiosity and a way of approaching subject matter that is just simply unique. Always very much about herself. I mean, this is also very, very much part of her gambit. So she would, like, what I find interesting about her work is she asks the question that nobody thinks to ask, but that you'd really like to know the answer to once she presents it. Like, for example, she goes to a bullfight, and she's fascinated by how the toreador keeps his britches up. How does he do that? I mean, you wouldn't think to ask that, would you? But you really kind of like to want to know, right? This is very Nelly. She pretty much gets thrown out of Mexico for writing some political material that was contentious. And back she comes to the Dispatch, thinking, now they are going to take me seriously. Now I'm going to have my moment. What happens? Nope. That is not happening. First they have her doing theater reviews, more fashion, more rubber raincoats. And she says, the heck with this. I'm going off to New York. So she leaves a note for QO, with whom she has become very close. And she says, dear QO, I'm off for New York. Look out for me. Lie. So she, with her mother in tow, travels to New York, first staying in a hall room up near Columbia, which I don't, yeah, Columbia was there, and then going every day down to Park Row, Newspaper Row, which you see here, right in the shadow of City Hall. It's all gone now, but these were the big newspaper establishments, and New York had like 10 or 12 competing papers at that time, morning and afternoon. She's knocking on every door. Nobody wants to hear about her. Even though she already had something of a reputation from Pittsburgh, but Pittsburgh was the provinces, you know, this is New York. So she gets the idea, this is very Nellie Bly, to interview every editor in New York about what place there is for women in journalism. Mm-hmm. That's how she's going to get in the door. Mm-hmm. Very smart. So she writes the piece, it runs in the Dispatch, it becomes a conversation piece among the journalism trade magazines, of which there were several at the time. And she starts to make her way. That gets her an appointment with John Cockerell, the New York World. This is now the late summer of 1887. And there were, everyone knows what Blackwell's Island was and what was going on here. There was a tourism pamphlet at the time that described it as the home of all the cancer spots of modern Manhattan. The almshouse, the prisons, I don't have to tell you, the asylums, etc. This is what populated the island. And there were reports at the asylums of abuses, rumored, you know, that nurses or doctors were taking liberty with patients, that things were going awry, that conditions were horrific. How are they going to find out? How is a reporter going to find out? Well, Nellie, being Nellie, comes into Cockerell's office armed with ideas. Her first idea was, let me travel steerage from Southampton to New York. Let me make that trip to see what it's really like to be an immigrant, because of course, the waves and waves of immigrants had started to come into the city. And they thought that was too dangerous and risky for a reporter whose work they didn't really know. But knowing that these abuses were rumored on the island, who exactly concocted the idea, sometimes Pulitzer's credited, sometimes Cockerell's credited, sometimes Nellie's credited, I can't tell you. I mean, there's documentation giving it to Cockerell as the idea, but that was in the annals of the world and the archives, and that could have been just ignoring the girl, you know, so who really knows whose idea it was. She also claimed credit. To feign insanity and get herself committed, and I'm sure this is a story you all know, so she agrees to do this. So she spends several days, maybe weeks, teaching herself how to seem insane, and develops this ruse to go into a boarding house downtown and terrorize the matron, basically, with her behavior in a way that is going to oblige the matron to call the police to come take her away. And, you know, almost on cue, this is exactly what happens. And so she goes before a judge. They think she's certifiably insane. She's used the dodge of saying she's from Cuba. Of course, she's had this 6 months in Mexico, so she's got a little Spanish. She calls herself Nellie Brown or Nellie Moreno and, you know, gives this dazed approach. Everybody certifies that she's insane. They take her to Bellevue. The doctors confirm the diagnosis. They put her on a ferry and ferry her across to the dreaded Blackwell's Island. And there she comes. And she remains there 10 days. She, you know, quietly absorbs everything around her. What she finds out is that the conditions are horrific, and everybody knows the bath story, you know, with the water going over her and the filthy towel and, you know, these horrible things. She meets people, foreign women who are not, are completely compass.
No, we don't know this.
Oh, you don't? I'll help you with that. So foreign women who are completely compass but can't make themselves understood and get agitated. I mean, you can imagine what that must be like, get thrown in here. Relatives who are trying to steal the bequests from deaths of other relatives, get the relatives thrown in here as insane so that they can claim their fortunes. I mean, there were a lot of these stories that one would really not hear unless somebody was inside being confided in. So this really became her métier. This became her way of doing things. She comes out after 10 days. She had been legally quashed before she went in with the district attorney's office. That's the only person they told, because of course what she was doing was illegal. You're also taking the space of someone who might need care. So there are a lot of reasons to get legal cover, which she had done. And then they arranged for her friend, the illustrator, Walt McDougall, and an attorney to come with a ruse to get her out. And that's how they managed to extract her. Her stories ran full page at the front of the Sunday section 2 weeks in a row in September. They were a sensation the likes of which the American press had never seen. I mean, maybe, you know, Livingston, you know, in Africa, that kind of a story had the same kind of appeal at that time, but it was so major. And remember, the New York papers exchanged with papers all over the country, so her reputation went far and wide. Further, in the 10 days that she was at the asylum, every other paper is asking, who is this insane girl? So they're all covering her because they think she's an insane girl, you know, who's been lost and found. And the whole thing is just an extraordinary episode. And then after her first story runs, the Sun tries to scoop the world. So they do all the reporting about what happened, and they run something just as long, you know, telling the whole story. But no one really knows who she is. Remember, she's a girl from Pittsburgh using a pen name, and nobody has a picture of her. So, I mean, she can go on doing this kind of work for quite a while, which is exactly what she does. So this is what the story looked like, and it was all heavily illustrated by McDougall. And then you can see the other papers talking about what she did, and then the world keeping it going. And then the exciting thing that happened, and really is probably why we remember her more than other people 140 years ago who've done similarly wonderful feats, and of course there have been so many wonderful journalists over the years, but what makes her special is there was action. The city council sent there was a grand jury here. The city council was sent to up the appropriation. The request was for $1 million extra. This is in 1887. Mm-hmm. Imagine how much money that was. And 90% of that was given for, you know, just to improve conditions for the insane across the island, and at least 60,000 to 70,000 went directly to the women's asylum. So that's impact. That's like journalistic gold. I mean, that's mm-hmm. the whole purpose, is to expose wrong and to get those in a position to act, to act. She does this at 22 years old with her first story. I mean, most people would be covering, you know, meetings of the Girl Scouts. I mean, it's just stunning, a stunning, stunning thing to happen. It gets made into a book. The book is exactly the stories that you find in the world, and you can find it online. Just look up 10 Days in the Madhouse. There's a million copies of it, all online. You can read the whole thing. You get a sense of how she writes. She writes about herself. I mean, she's always writing about herself, but she's engaging. You're sort of shocked by the things she says about herself, even. And the style is rough, but very effective. You know, just very effective. So that's fantastic. Well, 6 months in Mexico, guess what? They're looking for more material from Mary, from Nellie. She has all this material from Mexico, so all that gets reproduced in the book. She is on her way, having arrived in New York not 3 months before. Between the fall of 87 and 89, and I think this is really significant because what we remember her for, though I'm going to tell you her whole life, but what we remember her for is 2.5 years. She is writing every second or third day, doing these extraordinary exposés. Many girls were doing this kind of work at this time. She was a pioneer of this kind of work, maybe not the first, but some would do things like stand outside the Union Club to see who would solicit them, or they put on a bulletproof vest and get shot at, or go down in a diving bell, up in a balloon. Not Nellie. Hers always had a social agenda, and I think that's what also makes her very special. So from employment agents for low-wage workers, she would pose as someone trying to get work. Or trafficking in newborns, she would pose as someone wanting a baby to see how the trafficking would happen. Matrimonial agencies, the lives of chorus girls and dancers, she would explain that they're not harlots, they're girls that need to make a living and find this as a way that they can do better, or they can take care of their ailing mother in mourning and work at night or whatever. Orphanages, mesmerists, mind healers, physician fraud. Does this massive expose on fraud in Albany, posing as somebody willing to give a bribe, and of course catches up and then drives the guy out of town. It's a great story. Migrant workers, police matrons, how they were abusing prisoners, fraud against working girls, washing machine swindlers, on and on and on. These run like several times a week for this whole period. You can imagine how exhausted she was. Well, it gets to be the fall of 1889, and Cockrell has the idea to do something really sensational. I mean, the World was a sensational paper, but wonderfully written, exciting, appealed to these new masses of immigrant classes coming in. This is how they learned to read English, reading the World. It was full of gorgeous illustration. It had it all going on. They want to send somebody around the world to beat the fictional record of Phileas Fogg, which was 80 days, as we all know from the book. The book was about 13 years old at this point, and no one had attempted this feat. So they wanted to send a man, of course, because a man doesn't have to go with a round dozen trunks like a lady, right? So Nellie says, okay, you send a man, and I'm going to do it for another paper, and I will beat him. And so they give her the assignment. She has like 30 hours to prepare. She leaves with an alligator bag this size, not bigger than this. Couldn't even carry cold cream. Has a travel coat made, one dress, undergarments, and she is off. Little to her knowledge, Elizabeth Bislin was hired by Cosmopolitan magazine to go from San Francisco and try to beat her going the other direction. So there was this race, and there are books about the race that you can read. There have been a couple of books written about it. I do quite a lot with it, but people make a whole book out of it also, as they do about 10 Days in a Madhouse. I mean, you can make a book out of those things. Anyway, so she doesn't know about this. Now remember, she's sending back cables from every stop. You know, she goes by ship, by train, by jigsaw, you know, any possible means of travel at the time. They've got to fill space every day. So they're running, you know, this is the travel plan. You can see her trip. But they are running stories every single day. So what are they running? Guessing contests, geography lessons, letters from Nellie. Well, there are no letters from Nellie. She's sending back, you know, one-sentence cables. That's, you know, what she's going to send back to her ship. So that's all that. And then, of course, she's on ships for long periods of time. So they are just vamping all the time. But it is all over the country. It's just a sensation. And then she gets to San Francisco, finally, for the last lap. And of course, in the Rockies, you know, there's an avalanche. I mean, you know, the whole thing is just enormously exciting. If you like travel stories, hers is pretty good. She's shocked by torture methods she describes, all kinds of things. The way that the coolies are treated, the way that Egyptian boatmen are treated. I mean, she kind of deals with everything. The fact that on trains in Britain, this is so Nellie Bly, people are facing each other, you know, rather than not facing each other, and like how not good that is for a woman to be like, well, especially a woman traveling alone. I mean, very Nellie. This goes on and on and on. She finally gets home. She breaks the record. It's 72 days, 6 hours, and 11 minutes, and she beats Elizabeth Bislin, who, of course, you know nothing about. She was actually a better writer, let's just say. Okay, so that happens. There are board games. They arrange this whole trip around the world. Board game idea to, you know, keep the interest going. Her stories get made into a book. The story she writes on the train coming back from San Francisco gets republished as a book. And there are novelty hats, there are kerosene lamps. I mean, she's, you know, she's just a figure. She goes on the Chautauqua circuit and on other, you know, speaking engagements. I mean, she thinks she's got it made. What does Joseph Pulitzer do, her boss?
Nothing.
He's going to have a medal struck for her. We never hear if the medal existed. Mm-hmm. There is no raise, no bonus.
Wow.
And she is furious. Mm-hmm. And also, she's feeling her oats now because people want her. I mean, she's in her element. So you can see that the big toy companies, there are like three versions of this board game. Family story paper, dime novels. They hire her to write serial fiction. She can't write fiction. So, you know, one story appears and then not another one. So a lot of this great promise dissipated very quickly. And money, because of all that early history, is really an issue in her life. Like, establishing her family and establishing herself and not having this worry. So here we are at 1890, where everything looked very bright, and now it's looking a little dimmer, because this contract isn't working. She'd taken a farm out in Westchester and thought she's going to be a lady novelist, and that is really not going to happen. So she gets offered a job in Chicago at the Chicago Daily News, a paper that no longer exists, another tabloid very much like, you know, in the model of the world. And on the train, she meets Robert Livingston Seidman. He was 70 to her 30 at this point, and seems to be a very big industrialist. He owns the Ironclad Manufacturing Company in Brooklyn, this great big enterprise. He's in any big book of New York, his photograph is there in one of those ovals, and he is a personage. He has a townhouse on 37th Street, two doors down from where Eleanor Roosevelt was growing up, and they marry. And so it's Mr. and Mrs. Nellie Bly. I kind of love that. And this marriage turns out to be not so fabulous. So 37th Street, the townhouse mansion, she referred to as Bleak House. It had a terrible kitchen. He lived there with his brother, so that, you know, there was the brother. And she wanted to eat out every night. She didn't want to eat that fare. He would not give her money to do that. It was all pretty bleak. So, but she remained married to him, and he stayed alive for another, till 1904, let's say 1903, I think. And her friend Arthur Brisbane, who had been her editor and her friend in her early world days and really respected her, hires her to write some stories because she needs to make some pocket money. So she does things like, you know, poses an elephant trainer. People at this point know who she is, so the undercover stuff is pretty much over, the stuff that really made her reputation. She interviews Emma Goldman when she gets sent to the Tombs, mm-hmm. when she's imprisoned. It's the seminal interview with mm-hmm. Emma Goldman. Any Emma Goldman scholar will tell you that. Mm-hmm. Because Nellie could get you to reveal things that you just otherwise wouldn't talk about, even while she's telling you a lot about herself, which is mm-hmm. her way. Mm-hmm. Brisbane sends her to the Pullman strike in Chicago. You know, this is the big, big, big labor strike in American history. What does Nellie do? Everyone's writing about the riots and the police confrontations. No, she goes to the town of Pullman to see what's happening to the mothers and the children. Like, what is the strike doing to them? Her reporting is really great. And that it's kind of a Potemkin village. You know, it's not really what it's portrayed as, this model town for the working people. And then she goes to the political conventions, and here she is taming the tiger, you know, Tammany Hall being the tiger. I hope these give you a sense of who she was in the newspaper world. And the jealousy, you cannot imagine the jealousy. I mean, when you read the trade journals, they just trash her constantly. And then always, you know, will give adulation to some of the other women reporters, you know, but never to Nellie. Just, the claws are out. Anyway, so Nellie's husband dies, and he leaves her the factories. Only they're not worth very much. I mean, things are really a mess. She invents the steel barrel. She has like numerous patents, including the steel barrel, which she invents during this period. You can see this is from the Pan American Exposition of 1901. This is actually before he dies, so he must be failing, and then she's taking over his businesses. She also recreates them as a model of social welfare. So she's got the ping pong tables, and she's giving the turkey at Christmas and doing things to make worker life better, because this really was sincere in her. It wasn't just a reportorial pose. It was what she believed. She always was looking for a way from wherever she stood, and you'll see this more as her life devolves, to extend a hand to those who didn't have it, to give a voice to the voiceless, in that old phrase. By 1912, as the factory story is getting worse and worse, but she's still into it, she gets invited in 1913 to Alice Paul's big suffrage parade the day before Woodrow Wilson's inauguration. Really important parade. There have been five in New York. She wasn't a suffragist per se. I know a whole lot about that suffrage stuff. We can talk about it another time. But she was a fellow traveler. She wrote about the conventions, even back as early as 1880s, she had covered one of the big conventions in Washington. And she admonished these women as a fifth column, almost like a friend, to say, you all look horrible. You are not helping your cause by not being stylish. Clothes are a weapon. Why are you not using appearance as something for you? And you will see that over the next decade, the suffrage movement becomes very stylish. And, we can't say that we can attribute it to her, but there it was writ large in the New York World. So one wonders what impact her attitude had. Saying, you're not helping yourselves by looking dowdy. You don't attract the mass. So very Nellie. So they gave her a position as a herald in the parade. And, of course, Brisbane, who's now moved to the Evening Journal, ever her friend, has her write about her experience both being a herald, and of course her whole story is about her green outfit and her emerald eyes, and it's so nice. But in the middle of that, she also talks to John Milholland, who's the father of Inez Milholland, who was, sort of the major Gloria Steinem figure of the suffrage movement, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's also a great story, because it's so Nellie. Okay, then trouble really descends. So there seems to be fraud. People are stealing from her. She claims these are forged signatures. Her accountant has stolen all her money. Who knows exactly what happened? I don't think it's quite so clear. But robbing Nellie Bly, an amazing game, and things are really rocky. So what does she do? And then she puts the company in the name of her friend Oscar Bondi, who is a big sugar manufacturer in Austria. We are now in 1914. You'll get this in a minute. And her mother sues her and her brother because they want this company in their name while she's going. She's being betrayed by the people she has supported all her life. Try to imagine the impact of that. What does Nellie do? She gets a passport and she goes to Austria. Her timing is ideal because the war breaks out 2 days later. So now she's an enemy alien. Yeah. But it's not so bad. She's hanging out with the nobility. Things are not terrible. She gets Brisbane to give her a guest slot as a war correspondent. She is the only woman to cover the Eastern Front during World War I. She writes extraordinary stories from the trenches, really incredible. Then, of course, because of the enemy alien status, she can no longer do that. So I keep putting Brisbane up there. He's so cute. And here she is on the firing line. She really is doing that. And then more stories of that time, and then she starts asking, because she can't go to the front any longer, she starts writing about orphans and widows, something that's always been part of her theme. It's always been part of her theme, and so she's asking for help for them. And then she heads back to New York, but not without stopping at Versailles to see Wilson, who, of course, will not see her. But she is convinced that the Bolsheviks are coming, and they are going to be a menace, and that the Americans need to be much more conscious of this and much more on board. So she's trying to meet with military intelligence. She's trying to meet with Wilson at Versailles. They're kind of keeping her at bay, and military intelligence decides that basically she's Hattie, but not so Hattie that she can't be let back into the country. So, this is already 1919, the war is ending. And so she comes back home, penniless. Brisbane, in her probate file, there was a letter in her hand to him saying how much money she had, which was nothing. And he pays her $100 a week to become a columnist and to do a lot of sort of sob sister stories, because we're now at 1919, where women reporters are, you know, doing that sort of Chicago thing, you know. And she does a lot of these settling babies' identities, and she covers executions and all that. And she writes a regular column. And the column, you can use the abandoned boys, blah, blah, blah. She makes her column sort of a clearinghouse for, like, chorus girls who've had a child and there's no place to face the child, so to find foster housing for them. She becomes the guardian for one child who remains in an orphanage, but she makes a Persterpe's heir in her will, actually, which is how I located her alive when I was writing this book, and that was extraordinary. She was had some dementia, but remembered everything from 1912. I mean, could just tell you everything. It was quite extraordinary. So she wrote about that. She wrote about Seaman, because now her name, of course, was Elizabeth Cochran Seaman. And so American seamen who were being oppressed by foreign seamen who were working for lower wages, and capital punishment, which she very much opposed. She had witnessed several executions to work. So you get a picture of trials and all the things she covers. It's 1922. She's 58 years old. She gets pneumonia. She's heartbroken. Some of her columns are, you know, clearly disguised about what her family was doing to her. The home she bought them in Brooklyn, I think it was Park Slope, they took, you know, they just bled her dry. And she dies at 58 years old. So this is 1922, and we don't hear really anything about Nellie Bly, except she is a line in the Mack the Knife song. There's like, I can't remember where it is, but somewhere in the song there's just nothing about her until the 1950s. And this book comes out by Minion Rittenhouse. I have an extraordinary story about her, but we may not have time. But I read this book at 10 years old, and changed my life. I said, wow, I don't have to be a nurse or a teacher. I could do this. This would be a lot of fun. And it had that kind of impact on me. And I found out later that it had that impact on many, many women journalists of my age, because when my book was reviewed, all those years later, 40 years later, whatever it was, you cannot imagine how many reviews in the days where there were many book reviews, as opposed to today, started with the words, "When I was a girl of 10. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't just I. So there was that book. There was a second book that I didn't know about till many, many years later. More on that later. Then we fast forward to the 1970s, late 1970s, when it comes to the attention of the New York Press Club that her gravesite at Woodlawn does not have a marker. She was buried in an unmarked grave. There was nobody left to do anything for her. A life that had really been lived in many ways for others, though very much for herself. I mean, we have to say that, but very much for others. So they raised the money to dedicate a tombstone, which has been there since 78, as you can see, June 22nd. And they established a Cub Reporter Award in her name. That was also in the late 70s. And then nothing. Oh yeah, there was one other thing. There was, you may have seen this, there was a television movie with starring Linda Pearl, which you can still, I suppose, get on video. Not great, but you know, mostly about the trip around the world, because that's what people want to write about. I think her life is so much more interesting than that. And my book just comes out 20-odd years later, 1994. So there was a long time with nothing. I got the idea because my 10-year-old daughter had to do a school project about a woman, famous woman. So I said, you should do Nellie Bly. She was mom's patron saint. So we went looking for those books. This is now back in the early 80s, I guess. How old was Brett? 86, let's say. And so at that time, there was no Amazon, you know, old books. You had to go to a search firm, and they put an ad in the Antique Trader. You know, we went through all that. And two books came back. The first one I showed you, and then the second. And Brett is reading them both, and they disagree about everything, so it was clear they'd been heavily fictionalized because there was no material. It was just like not impossible, but very hard to find stuff. So Brett says, you should write one. Yeah. And I thought, that's not a bad idea. I could do that. So that's how the book came to happen. Then soon after, Jason Marks, wrote this Around the World in 80 Days, 82 Days. He wrote a lot about the trip of the two of them, Elizabeth Bislin and Nellie. Then National History Day. Does anybody have kids who've done National History Day? It's a major competition across the country every year. Every year it's a different theme. And every year, Nellie Bly fits that theme because I get anywhere from 10 to 50 calls because they have to interview one live person. So I have a whole thing on my website that says, if you want to call me, this is what you have to do first because this is a history project. So do some history. But it's a lot of fun. And so that's another way that her legacy has stayed current. And it's interesting, you know, that she still has this kind of appeal that I felt as a teen. She still has that for young girls coming of age now. It's always girls. It's always girls. And then after my book came out, John Englert, this wonderful man in Armstrong County, which is, of course, the Pennsylvania county that she was from, ran a campaign to get her admitted to the National Women's Hall of Fame. She was admitted, so she's been there. You can remember soon after that, remember West Wing? You know, they did a whole Nellie Bly segment. And there have been times where, you know, she's come back a little bit at a time. Postage stamp, I got to, you know, be a referee on that. That was a lot of fun. And then the American Experience did a wonderful documentary called Around the World in 72 Days, but they do a fantastic Madhouse bit. And you know, the American Experience is such a great series, so that's really worth seeing. 80 Days is the book, again, about the trip around the world. I mean, I get asked by producers almost every second year, someone wants to buy the rights to the book, and they only want to do the Madhouse or the trip around the world. Now, don't you think they're wrong? They're wrong. They're wrong. The story's better than that. But anyway, that's what people do. And there are so many children's books that have come out since my book, because now, of course, there's something to, you know, purloin. So there are plenty of children's books. Almost every year there's a new one. And this came out about a year ago. It's, you can find it on Amazon. It's sort of a horror movie about the Madhouse.
Don't discuss it. It's a horrible movie.
A horrible movie. A horrible movie. He likes to throw my name around. I had nothing to do with this. And then now we've heard that Christina Ricci and Judith Light are going to do a Nellie Bly movie. This is in production for Lifetime. Kate Mara has got another project going on. There's another one I know that's sort of in the offing, and there's stuff. And this is really fun. This is an animated documentary that's just about to come out, and you can see the trailer if you go to Nellie Bly Makes the News. And it's all animated, but it's very historical. I'm actually a character, and I have an avatar who is not so cute, but I thought, wow, that's how they sound. Okay. And there she is, our girl. And this was her motto: energy rightly applied can accomplish anything. And I, you know, just think it's astounding that she retains her ability to provoke and to inspire. And I'm glad I wrote that book. Aww. Thank you all. So I would like to ask, if there's anything you'd like to go a little deeper on, you know, it's a really fat book. Yes. Oh. 100 pages are endnotes, because I felt that it was so hard to find the material that I had to make it available for the future. So this book is actually an archive. It says where the bodies are buried, where you can find this, where you can find that, because it was all really hard to find. But anyway.